Good evening and welcome to the City of Reading Environmental Advisory Council's Our City, Our World program, which airs every other month here on BCTV. Tonight's topic is sustainable development for the City of Reading, but before we start talking about tonight's topic, I wanted to introduce myself and my guest and to talk a little bit about the EAC, the Reading Environmental Advisory Council, and what it does. So I am David Beane. I am a member of the city's EAC and have been since 2010. I am the immediate past chair of the EAC, and I am an environmental lawyer by trade. That's all I do. That's all I have been doing for about the past 30 years. With me this evening, to my right, is Cathy Curran Myers. Cathy is the current chair of the EAC and has been, I guess, for the last 2 years. Cathy is an assistant professor of environmental law, policy, and sustainability at Alvernia University. And she is also a former deputy secretary for water management at the Pennsylvania Department of Environmental Protection. Cathy is also a lawyer. So welcome, Cathy. Thank you for joining me on tonight's program.
Thank you, David.
So the EAC, the city's Environmental Advisory Council, has been around since 2007. We do a number of things. Our biggest role is an educational one. We are tasked under our ordinance, under the ordinance that created the EAC, with promoting sustainability initiatives, environmental initiatives within the city limits, and raising awareness about impacts to soil, water, and air within the city. We are also charged when City Council has an issue concerning the environment that comes up at a council meeting about a contaminated property. Many viewers, for instance, might be familiar with the lead issue in southeast Reading that was discovered by EPA about a year or two ago. We were heavily involved with that initiative in terms of, you know, receiving reports from council and being asked by council, what is this all about? What do we as a city need to do to respond to this discovery? So part of what we do concerns sustainable development, and that's what we're here to talk about this evening. The title of this evening's presentation is Sustainable Development for Reading, Working with the Natural Landscape. And there's an emphasis there on the word with, as opposed to working against the natural landscape. Within the world of environmental law and policy, within the last probably two decades, there has been a movement towards, and it's not just a voluntary movement. I mean, there are now regulatory programs in place that require the regulated community, including municipalities, to start looking at sustainable development. And sustainable initiatives. I mean, sustainability needs to now be a part of our dialogue as a regulated community. So whether it's the EAC, whether it's City Council looking at issues like development, we now need to look at development with an eye towards sustainability as a factor that we need to consider. So with that, Cathy, you're a professor. When you talk to your classes about sustainability and sustainable development, what do you mean? What are you talking to your students about?
Well, that's something we should start with, because many people don't really have a good idea about what sustainability really is and what do we mean by that, and people use the term for all kinds of things. But when we talk about sustainability in public policy, we're really talking about practices and policies that will look at the long-term consequences of decisions we make today, and we'll make sure that the decisions we make today take into account the environmental quality needs of our children and grandchildren. It turns out that one of the best examples of a sustainable policy really comes to us from the Native Americans, especially the Iroquois nations in the Northeast. And they had a practice where all decisions had to consider the impact on what they called the seventh generation. So the elders were tasked to make decisions contemplating how that decision would play out over not just your children and grandchildren, as we often speak of, but your great, 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 great grandchildren, seven generations. So they're looking far out before they make a decision. And we're trying to, in this fast-paced world where we want instant gratification, want to fix it now, we're trying to shift to have a longer view, and that's what sustainability is all about. The other thing we should mention on sustainability is that Reading really has a good start. It has focused on trying to rebuild our community with a view for the long term and for environmental quality that makes the quality of life here better and attractive to everyone. And we did recently receive, the city of Reading has recently received a 3-star rating from the national organization which assesses how cities are doing in terms of sustainability. And we received that 3-star rating, which very few cities have done, which means we're in a good starting place. And it also identifies for us things that we can do better to improve the quality of life here in Reading and ensure that we are looking at the long term for the seventh generation as well. So just backing up a little, because I like to put things in context. Professors always do that. Think about our past. In the 19th and 20th century, the trend of modernization and progress was to conquer nature and to re-engineer everything. And my favorite example of that is in the city of Chicago. And I'd like to bring up the first visual here, because I want to show you the city of Chicago. This is on St. Patrick's Day. They turn the river bright green, or the leprechauns must do that, I suppose. But the other important and exciting thing about the Chicago River is it used to flow into Lake Michigan from the city. But with waterborne disease in the 19th century, there was cholera and typhoid, and the city father said, well, you engineers, couldn't you just make it flow the other way? And couldn't we flush all that sewage out to the Mississippi River? And they said, sure, we can do that. So they, instead of being a divide where all the Great Lakes waters stay in the Great Lakes and the Mississippi River waters stay in the Mississippi, they dug a channel through and made the Chicago River flow and send all the sewage down to the Mississippi River, getting rid of their problem, which we frequently do, send it to the people downhill or downstream. That is still the case and has created large new problems when invasive species that get to the Great Lakes hitchhiking on ships from the Caspian Sea and places in Europe and Asia escape into the Great Lakes and can now escape all the way down to New Orleans, which has not been very beneficial to the fisheries or the people who enjoy that river. So we need to think more carefully before we do some of these, fix nature so that it does what we want. Bringing that back locally to Reading, I was looking at some of the pictures of Reading to try and help visualize the inheritance, the legacy we received in the city because of that idea that we're going to put people's things where we want them and just lay it out without regard to the landscape. The next visual I have is from an old postcard. And we could bring that up. Oh, I could bring that up probably. Let me do that. All right. This is from a postcard of, and you can see that's Penn Street, but I think it shows you really clearly that we have the buildings, and right next to the buildings are the sidewalks, and right next to the sidewalks is the very, very wide avenue, which is lovely. But there's no place for any water or raindrops to go, and there is no green at all, except in the lovely surrounding mountains. So we just plunked the city down, and that's still what we're having to live with, because there is no place for the water to go, and we took away a lot of the trees. Now the arborists are doing a good job, and people are doing a good job planting new trees and trying to get islands and green back in the city, and greenways and pedestrian ways. But that's what we have to undo, is some of that. So I know even before I didn't arrive on the Environmental Advisory Council till we moved here to Reading in 2012, but you were already doing things to start an initiative to develop some ordinance that would encourage future development in Reading to really respect the natural landscape and think about the natural resources when doing further development of the land. Could you share some of that was done?
And you know, a lot of those initiatives were really driven by stormwater. Mm-hmm. Because you know, within the last five or 10 years, there has been a real initiative at the federal and state level to really control, to further control the way municipalities manage stormwater flow. There was a time 50 or 60 years ago, out of sight, out of mind, we don't want to see it, you know, just send it to the rivers. We've now reached a point where there are mandates, federal mandates and state mandates, to capture stormwater flow and to keep it on the property where it falls. And these mandates are only going to get stricter over time. For instance, to use Philadelphia as an example, Philadelphia and their collection system is different than the one we have here, but Philadelphia is dealing with a situation right now where they have imposed a stormwater tax. They are encouraging residents as a way of mitigating that tax to employ best management practices with respect to stormwater to keep stormwater on their own properties, whether it's by way of rain gardens, roof gardens, pervious pavers that allow rainwater to fall mm-hmm. on paved surfaces yet percolate through. With that initiative at the federal and state level, we began to think locally here in the city that we need to really start taking a good hard look at our local ordinances to see how we can assist with that endeavor, because we know at some point in the future we're going to be forced to do it. So rather than wait until that point in time, we figured, let's be proactive and let's try to identify some ways where we can facilitate this process and move it forward. The first initiative we really thought about was a rain barrel mm-hmm. ordinance. It wasn't mandatory, it's voluntary. But what we did, we revised the current ordinances in the city to permit local residents, if they want to install rain barrels on their property. Because part of our mission is education-driven, we coupled drafting that ordinance and getting it approved with workshops that we presented throughout the city for a period of several years, educating people about the ordinance, telling them if you're going to install a rain barrel, this is how you do it, these are the restrictions, these are things you need to take a look at. We also did some other things. Recycling is inherently tied in with sustainability, so we've been working very closely with the Public Works Department in the city over the last several years to raise awareness locally about recycling. Recycling is mandated within the city. This is not, unlike the rain barrel ordinance, this is not a voluntary program, so everyone needs to participate in it, but not everyone does. So, we've been working not only with the older generations within the city, but also with students to raise awareness with them, in the hope that they will, take these discussions that we've been having with school students home and have these discussions with their parents and hopefully increase opportunities for recycling. We've also been working with Public Works on the recycling and, for instance, electronic recycling, which is now mandated. We've been working closely with Public Works to both expand opportunities locally for electronic recycling and to educate people that it's a requirement and it's something they need to do. There are two other ordinances that we have worked on and have had passed by council over the course of the last several years that deal with sustainability. One is what's called a riparian buffer ordinance. So that is an ordinance that mandates, in essence, you can't build right up to the Schuylkill River. There needs to be a buffer zone in there. So as rainwater falls on the ground and is traveling towards the Schuylkill, in essence, you have a wetland buffer area that is going to capture as much of that runoff as it possibly can. That way you're not dumping all of that sediment and runoff directly into the Schuylkill River, and you're allowing for recharge of the aquifers.
Sure. So whatever you're doing on that property, we have a little insurance policy if we've got a little green strip
That's
along
right.
the stream. whether you're farming or manufacturing, whatever you're doing isn't as likely to get in the stream and affect everybody's drinking water as well.
That's right. And the other big ordinance we've worked on is an alternative energy ordinance. So, alternative energy, people think of solar, they think of wind, they think of geothermal. So we worked on getting that ordinance passed as well. I mean, all of these have a connection with sustainability, and it's been a slow process. We recognize that we can't modify all of the ordinances overnight, and it's really one of our long-term objectives as an EAC to continue working on issues of sustainable development.
Right.
That gets us to one of the things we're here to talk about this evening, and that's steep slopes, because that's a new ordinance that, it's not so new, because we probably started working on this ordinance probably 5 or 6 years ago in response to a mandate from the Berks County Planning Commission. All of this ties in with stormwater, because at the time there was a requirement placed on the city to adopt a steep slope ordinance and a riparian buffer ordinance, all connected with wanting to better manage stormwater flow within the city. So, we got the riparian buffer ordinance passed pretty quickly. There have been some problems with the steep slope ordinance. It's much more complicated. It has taken more time to educate council about it and to get input from various stakeholders who are interested in that ordinance. We'll get into this in a little bit, but we finally reached a point where that ordinance is getting closer to being passed. So, I guess transitioning into the area of steep slopes, as a professor, what do you talk to your students about when you talk about the threat of steep slopes? What threats do steep slopes pose to urban environments like the city of Reading?
Okay, well, there's obvious ones that people will think about, which we see mostly in dramatic pictures in California of structures and buildings and landslides just sliding down the hill, and that can certainly happen. But most of the time, the real issue is, as you've already hinted, it's water. And we continue not to appreciate the power of water when it works in connection with gravity. And when the power of gravity to send water downhill, gather those raindrops together, and turn it into a scary flood torrent is amazing. And we always underestimate the power of water when it's not raining, and it seems we're always surprised at how deep the water gets and how fast it rushes and how much gets carried along with it if we let that rainwater get together and get downhill. So in addition to land movement, because the water gets the soil gets saturated and it begins to act like a fluid and it all wants to go downhill, then you have the runoff running across the top and taking debris and soil with it, creating gullies, undermining roads, undermining bridges at the abutment where they connect, making our bridges unsafe, causing us millions and millions of dollars of infrastructure needs. And then some surprising structural instability, not so much in this city, but if you have sewage systems within an area, they can be shifted, but because of steep slopes and that combination, that downward pull of gravity, making things that otherwise would on a flat surface would be stable, making them just want to roll downhill. But there are a couple other surprising things that I want to mention. One of them is fire. It turns out that fire actually goes much faster and on a steep slope. You can think of how when you hold a match, if you hold it vertically, it's pretty slow. If you tip it, it starts to burn pretty fast. And the reason is that the flames then heat up the upward part of the slope, and so it moves. And in fact, studies have been done that say fire goes twice as fast on a steep slope as it does on the flat. And I did bring.
And I was just going to say, if memory serves me correctly, we actually had a fire on a steep slope within the city within the last year or two.
We did. And here's a picture from Reading Magazine of a fire in Mount Penn. And it was near my house in Hampden Heights. And it started right behind the high school. And it shot up to the top of the mountain in no time at all because it's very steep there. I take my dogs through there and they chase deer. And that's okay, no harm. But fire can really rip through, and the double whammy on that is that then the firemen have to get equipment up there to fight a fire. So We really need to not build things up on steep slopes as much as we can. And those are some of the major problems.
So, you know, what we did as an EAC, we actually had the benefit of a local grad student, and a shout out to Jonathan Wood. Jonathan helped us draft our initial steep slope ordinance several years ago. Did a fine job. He attended all of our EAC meetings for, you know, an entire semester.
I have to make a plug because he's in the program I now coordinate, which is a master's in leadership for sustainable communities. So he was in that master's program at Alvernia.
Well, so. Yeah, very responsive, very responsible young man, and did a fantastic job on our initial draft. The initial draft of the ordinance met with some resistance from City Council and from the Planning Commission in terms of overreach. They thought it was a little bit too expansive, and they asked us to scale it back somewhat. So I guess my next question for you is, since you were intimately involved with the redraft of our steep slope ordinance, if you can just sort of highlight for our audience the points of that redrafted ordinance and how it's going to affect them.
Right. Well, as David said, we went through several years of discussions and got some feedback from the county and the local planning agencies. One of the concerns they had is that you'd need an engineer to figure out what parts of your property are steep slope. And if people didn't know they were probably in a steep slope area, they wouldn't know to do that, and that seems unfair and unreasonable. So they really wanted to have a map to help guide people. And, of course, we didn't have a map, but we hunted and we looked and we got some help from Deb Hogue, the city's environmental engineer, who's left us, unfortunately, but she did a lot of good work on this. And that effort resulted in finding a good map of the slopes in our community. Which looked like this.
Right.
So this map we found was part of the proposed new comprehensive plan. So it's being looked at, it's being incorporated into the long-term comprehensive plan for the city. So we thought, okay, let's see if we can use that and satisfy people's concerns, which seemed to be legitimate. People should be on notice. And this shows, we originally had three areas, some of Cumroof Township and Berks County itself have steep slope ordinances, and they use three levels of sort of mildly sloped, moderately sloped, and steeply, severely sloped. And we had started with a lot like Cumroof Township ordinance, but looking at the map, it really only deals with what would be sort of steep slopes, which is 15% to 25% slope on the property, or very steep slopes, which is over 25%. So I thought, well, those are the most serious ones to avoid and the ones that really need attention. So let's scale this back and just go with the steep slopes and the very steep slopes and match the map so that people can, if the red areas you can see, you can guess where that is. Those red areas are Neversink and Mount Penn, and then areas here and there, where there are those little hills that we have in town, and those, all those areas, and then the yellow areas, where you should also be careful where you do have the slope. So people would then know that if they're on one of those, they need to have an engineer before they build something new, because they really need to be careful for structural integrity and not to have the things slide downhill.
So if we have a property owner who either wants to develop on a steep slope or to redevelop on a steep slope, you know, they'll be getting an engineer involved. They have to under the new ordinance. And, you know, what type of restrictions are they looking at?
The main restrictions are not to add as much as you would be allowed to do on flat property in terms of impervious area, so that we reduce the amount of the total property that can be impervious, can be under concrete and roof, just a little bit. And the other, so that we still have areas that can receive the rain, and we try and for redevelopment, we ask people to avoid the steep slopes with any new materials, new access roads, driveways to try and avoid the steep slope. On new property, where you're more free to, you really must avoid the steep slope for structures and roads and the most serious problematic kinds of development, to stay off that steep slope. When people have already developed part of the property, there's some wiggle room of saying, well, if it's not, please try to avoid it with equipment and expansion. But if you really can't get an access or something else that you really need, there's some wiggle room on the existing property. Try to keep, you can always keep within your existing footprint, so if something would burn down or fall down, you can rebuild, even if you're on the steep slope part, but not to make that worse by sending any additions out to the steep slope.
What about exemptions for, let's say, smaller projects?
Right, that was the other problem. This is a zoning ordinance, and as everybody probably knows, almost everything you need to do needs to get a zoning permit. Even pretty small things need that zoning approval. We didn't really want to require someone to get an engineer and do this kind of investigation for really small projects. So we exempted projects that are like decks and patios under 500 square feet, which would be a pretty darn big deck or patio. So because the intention is not to look at projects like that. We just really need to look at the ones that are troubling, like a new driveway and garage, things right. like that. If they're on the hill, you all have seen driveways that act like a waterfall and a sluiceway when it rains. Right. So we want to avoid any more of that.
Okay, so we have less than a minute left. I do want to say that the steep slope ordinance has been submitted to council mm-hmm. for formal consideration. That was submitted on March the 12th. And that will be subject to public hearing and comment. So I would encourage our viewing audience, check council's agenda on the city's website. The EAC also has a page on the city's website where you can get additional information about the ordinance. Please feel free to check that out. And you know, be a part of the process. If you have questions about the ordinance, show up at the city council meeting, you know, where this will be formally considered. You can certainly call City Hall and get additional information.
Yes, and in fact, our deputy clerk, who serves as our secretary, has her contact information on our website so that you can send questions into her too. Now that wouldn't be official comment, but if you wanted to find out how to participate right. more, you can do that.
Right. So stay tuned. There will be further, more information about this will be forthcoming in future episodes. And with that, we will sign off. Thank you for watching.